ऑफिस से आया है आदेश, लेह लद्दाख में कोई मिलिट्री ड्यूटी जा रही है 5-6 जुलाई, हम समझे
ना।
हमें नहीं लेके जा रहे, हमसे उन्होंने बोला है कि क्लाइंट्स अगेंस्ट चिल्ड्रन का है कि आगे दे सकते हैं, तो कॉलेज बना रहा है, यह बनाने तो फिर आपको दिखा के फिर।
Hello, good afternoon everyone. All right, so I will just get started. Namaskar and welcome everyone. I'm Richa Dwivedi and today Namaskar and welcome everyone. I'm Richa Dwivedi and today we meet to mark the International Day Against Drug Abuse and Illicit Activity and discuss some very important developments in this regard. Observed on June 26th, the IDADA NIT was proclaimed by the United Nations in December 1987. Today, we mark the culmination of a week-long celebration. To leave no stone unturned in this discussion and to ensure that we discuss all facets related to drug abuse and illicit trafficking, we are joined today by experts from National Commission for Protection of Child Rights, the Narcotics Control Bureau, the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, as well as doctors with the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and AIIMS, who have personally overseen ground-level implementation of welfare initiatives, particularly when it comes to children. Our focus today is a joint action plan by the NCPCR and the NCB on prevention of drugs and substance abuse amongst children and illicit trafficking. The idea behind this joint action plan has been to create a solid framework to discourage and distance children from drug abuse and trafficking, and to also adopt a holistic approach to address the issue of drugs and substance use with the nation's young. Based on the vision of Ek Yudh Nashe Ke Virudh, this plan is a very important step towards achieving the goal of a Nasha Mukt Bharat. To tell us more about the vision behind the Joint Action Plan and NCPCR's role in this fight against drugs, it is my honor to invite Sri Priyank Kanungo, the chairperson of National Commission for Protection of Child Rights, Government of India, to deliver the inaugural address for today's webinar. Sir, I would like to request you to kindly inaugurate this webinar with your address and tell us all about your journey and vision of making of the Joint Action Plan for Prevention of Children from Drugs and Substance Abuse and Illicit Trafficking and the role that NCPCR has played.
Thank you. थैंक यू सो मच, बहुत धन्यवाद। आज जब हम इस सप्ताह भर चले सभी जगह के सभी इंस्टीट्यूशंस के अलग अलग कार्यक्रमों का समापन कर रहे हैं, चाहे वो एनसीबी हो, चाहे वो मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ सोशल जस्टिस हो, चाहे वो हेल्थ मिनिस्ट्री हो या एजुकेशन मिनिस्ट्री हो, तब हम ये देख रहे हैं कि आज इस ज्वाइंट एक्शन प्लान को क्रियान्वित करने के लिए सभी लोग साथ में जुटे हैं और आज का ये कार्यक्रम भी इसी तरफ इंगित कर रहा है। मैं बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूँ नारकोटिक्स कंट्रोल ब्यूरो का, डीडीजी सचिन जैन साहब का, कि उन्होंने न केवल इस एक्शन प्लान के बनने में एक बहुत ही इम्पोर्टेंट रोल अदा किया है, बल्कि इसको क्रियान्वित करने के लिए भी वो अपनी कमर कसे हुए और हमारे साथ हमेशा बच्चों के लिए समय देने के लिए या जैसे भी आवश्यकता पड़ती है तैयार है और आज भी हमारे साथ हैं। मैं बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूँ राधिका चक्रवर्ती जी का कि मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ सोशल जस्टिस की तरफ से ना केवल वो आज यहाँ पर हैं, बल्कि मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ सोशल जस्टिस का इस पूरे के पूरे ऑपरेशन में, इस पूरे के पूरे काम में हमको लगातार हमेशा मार्गदर्शन सहयोग पूरी तरीके से मिलता आ रहा है। मैं बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूँ डॉक्टर सुमिता घोष जी का, एडिशनल कमिश्नर है राष्ट्रीय बाल स्वास्थ्य कार्यक्रम की। मैं बहुत मन पूर्वक आपको धन्यवाद इस चीज के लिए करना चाहूंगा कि आपने अपने शेड्यूल में से ना केवल आज के लिए समय निकाला, बल्कि आपके राष्ट्रीय बाल स्वास्थ्य कार्यक्रम के डॉक्टर्स जो देश भर के स्कूल्स में जाके बच्चों का हेल्थ चेकअप कर रहे हैं, इस एक्शन प्लान में वो जाकर ये भी देखने वाले हैं कि कोई अर्ली इंडिकेटर्स अगर बच्चों में सब्सटेंस अब्यूज के हों और आप उसके लिए ट्रेनिंग प्रोवाइड करने से लेकर के इम्प्लीमेंटेशन तक में जो आपने आगे बढ़कर जो अपनी हेल्प एक्सटेंड की है, देश के 55 करोड़ बच्चे मैम आरबीएस के प्रोग्राम के एक बार पुनः इसके लिए धन्यवाद करेंगे। मैं बहुत धन्यवाद करना चाहता हूँ डॉक्टर अंजू धवन जी का, जो एम्स के एनडीडीटीसी से एनडीटीसी का बहुत बड़ा रोल इस एक्शन प्लान को इम्प्लीमेंट करने में है। ट्रेनिंग मॉड्यूल बनाना हो या ट्रेनिंग कंडक्ट करना हो या इस एक्शन प्लान को लिखने का काम रहा हो, हमें हमेशा वैल्यूएबल इनपुट्स मिले और हमेशा आपका गाइडेंस हमको मिला है। और ये बात कहते हुए मुझे बिल्कुल भी कोताही नहीं कि कमीशन की एक्सपर्टीज इन सब चीजों की अकेले की तो बिल्कुल भी नहीं थी, और आप लोगों ने जिस तरीके से हेल्प की और होल हार्टेडली इस पूरे आइडिया को वेलकम किया जो कि प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी जी के इस विजन को लेके था कि नए भारत में बच्चों को हम से कम नशे की बुराई से बचा सकें, और ये बहुत ही रोबस्ट मैकेनिज्म एक तैयार हुआ। निश्चित रूप से कमीशन के तरफ से हमारी मेंबर सेक्रेटरी रूपाली बनर्जी सिंह जी इस पूरे ज्वाइंट एक्शन प्लान के इम्प्लीमेंटेशन को डिजाइनिंग को देखने वाली शाइस्ता जी, आप लोगों का बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण योगदान इस पूरे के पूरे कार्यक्रम को शुरू करने के लिए है, और मैं आप सभी का बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूँ इस बात के लिए। मैं यहाँ पे केवल एक बात कहना चाहूंगा, बहुत ज्यादा समय नहीं लूंगा, क्योंकि आज जो लोग हमारे साथ जुड़े हैं, देश भर के स्टेट कमीशन के लोग हमारे साथ हैं, अलग अलग जगह के लोग हैं, वो आप लोगों को सुनना चाहते हैं, आपकी एक्सपर्ट सलाह लेना चाहते हैं कि कैसे बच्चों को वो सब्सटेंस अब्यूज से दूर रख सकते हैं। मैं केवल एक्शन प्लान के बारे में बहुत शॉर्ट में ये बताना चाहूंगा कि ये एक्शन प्लान ना केवल ड्रग्स, उन ड्रग्स की बात करता है जो प्रतिबंधित हैं, ये उन ड्रग्स की भी बात करता है जो मेडिकल स्टोर से बिक रही हैं लेकिन गलत तरीके से बच्चों के हाथ लग जाती हैं। उनकी मॉनिटरिंग के लिए ना केवल ये एक्शन प्लान सीसीटीवी कैमराज के थ्रू मॉनिटर करने की बात करता है, बल्कि मेडिकल स्टोर्स के रिकॉर्ड का मिलान फैक्ट्रीज से हो सके और फैक्ट्रीज के रिकॉर्ड का मिलान जो इंडस्ट्री को ओपीएम की सप्लाई होती है वहां से हो सके, इसके लिए एक रोबस्ट मैकेनिज्म के रूप में एमआईएस तैयार करने की भी बात करता है। ये एक्शन प्लान ना केवल स्कूल के 100 मीटर्स के दायरे से किसी भी प्रकार के सब्सटेंस की दुकान को हटाने की बात करता है, बल्कि बच्चों को खुद ही चाइल्ड इंस्पेक्टोरेट के रूप में, प्रहरी के रूप में, खुद के स्कूल के आसपास के इलाके की इस प्रकार की बुराइयों से सफाई का एक जिम्मेदारी का भाव भी देता है, जिससे वो करते करते खुद सीखेंगे और एक अच्छे नागरिक बनने की तरफ हम लोग जब बच्चों को आगे बढ़ाते हैं तो ये उनका एक बड़ा योगदान, उनका राइट टू पार्टिसिपेशन भी इस पूरी के पूरी प्रोसेस में इंश्योर करने का काम करता है। हमको यहाँ पे ये भी देखना होगा कि केवल रिपोर्टिंग बढ़ाने के साथ साथ ये एक्शन प्लान बात करता है अर्ली आइडेंटिफिकेशन की भी, चाहे गांव हो या शहर हो। राष्ट्रीय बाल स्वास्थ्य कार्यक्रम के डॉक्टर्स हर जगह जाते हैं और बच्चों के साथ इंटरेक्ट करते हैं, बच्चों का चेकअप करते हैं, और हमारी इस रिक्वेस्ट को उन्होंने बड़ी ही हर्ष के साथ स्वीकार किया कि जब डॉक्टर्स जाते हैं तो ये एक आइडेंटिफिकेशन का इंडिकेटर भी हमारे लिए प्लीज डेवलप कर दें कि अगर कोई बच्चे सब्सटेंस अब्यूज की गिरफ्त में है, चाहे वो गुटखा हो, चाहे वो बीड़ी हो या वो सिगरेट हो या वो किसी और प्रकार के सब्सटेंस हो, तो वो हमें बताने में मदद कर सके। एक जो इम्पोर्टेंट बात इसमें है, ये ना केवल स्कूली बच्चे बल्कि आउट ऑफ स्कूल बच्चे, वो बच्चे जो स्ट्रीट्स पर हैं, वो बच्चे जो इनहेलेंट्स के सेवन में गिरफ्त हैं, उन सब के रिहेबिलिटेशन की भी बात करता है। और आयोग का ही जो स्ट्रीट चिल्ड्रन का एक स्टैंडर्ड ऑपरेटिंग प्रोसीजर है या जो चाइल्ड लेबर के लिए स्टैंडर्ड ऑपरेटिंग प्रोसीजर्स हैं, उनके कंसोनेंस में बात करता है। तो कुल मिला के ये पहली बार हमने कोशिश की है कि सभी मिनिस्ट्री, सभी डिपार्टमेंट्स मिलकर एक मंच पे आके ये कसम खा के काम करें कि हम भाई बच्चों को अब किसी भी प्रकार से सब्सटेंस अब्यूज की गिरफ्त में नहीं जाने देंगे, और पंचायत से लेकर के स्कूल से लेकर के मंत्रालय के लेवल तक सभी लोग एक ही एंथुसियाज्म के साथ काम कर सकें, ये कोशिश है। मुझे उम्मीद है कि हम जैसे जैसे कोविड की स्थिति में नॉर्मल हो रहे हैं, इसका इम्प्लीमेंटेशन हम इफेक्टिवली कर पाएंगे। आप सभी का बहुत बहुत पुनः धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू सो मच प्रियांक जी। नेक्स्ट ऑन द पैनल वी हैव श्री सचिन जैन जी, हु इज द डीडीजी ऑफ नारकोटिक्स कंट्रोल ब्यूरो। इन नारकोटिक्स कंट्रोल Bureau, as the DDG, he is entrusted with responsibilities of policy and coordination wing along with general administration. Welcome to this webinar, sir. As we all generally know, the Narcotics Control Bureau is a premier drugs law enforcement agency of our nation. Kindly brief the viewers on the main role of Narcotics Control Bureau in area of drugs and substance abuse and illicit trafficking.
Thank you, Richa ji. To begin with, I would like to extend my gratitude to Chairperson NCPCR, Shri Priyanka Nungo sir, for organizing this webinar on this important issue that we are facing today. As he has rightly said that we are basically celebrating this week-long celebration with respect to this 26th June, that is basically International Day Against Drug Abuse and Illicit Trafficking. So the idea behind NCB was basically we were facing a lot of issues regarding the drug trafficking in India. NCB was constituted, established in 1986, in March 1986. And the major role to begin with was entrusted to NCB was to protect, to prevent the drug supply in India. So NCB is working with the single motto of not only with the single motto, but the one of the important motto of NCB was to prevention of any kind of drug supply in India, either within India or from outside India to India, and as well as from India to outside India. That is the premier role that NCB is basically portraying. But that is not the only thing. NCB is working and basically working three major areas. That one is this supply reduction. It is also participating in the field of demand reduction with the Ministry of Social Family Health, Social Welfare and Health as well. We are also working in close coordination with Ministry of Health as far as the harm reduction of drugs in country. So that is with respect to the threefold objective of NCB. In this regard, I would like to give some data to the viewers that pichle ek saal mein hum logo ne kareeban 7000 crore ki jo drugs hain wo usko seize kiya hai, jisme around 70,000 kg ke aaspaas ganja hai, around 1200 kg ke aaspaas heroin hai, and around 1200 kg के आसपास ओपियम है, हशीश है जिसको हम लोग चरस के नाम से भी जानते हैं, एंड डिफरेंट स्टिमुलेंट्स हैं, डिफरेंट सिंथेटिक ड्रग्स हैं जो कि आज की डेट में युवा पीढ़ी खास तौर पर उनका सेवन कर रही है. सो दैट इज वन एस्पेक्ट दैट वी आर बेसिकली वर्किंग. द अनदर थिंग एज फार एज बिकॉज एज मुझसे पूछा गया कि एनसीबी का मेजर रोल इस फील्ड में क्या है, तो एनसीबी काम कर रही है स्टेट और सेंटर की जो दूसरी ड्रग लॉ एनफोर्समेंट एजेंसीज हैं उनके कोऑर्डिनेशन में. उस संदर्भ में एक चार स्तर पर एक कोऑर्डिनेशन मैकेनिज्म बनाया गया जिसमें हम लोग स्टेट के साथ कोऑर्डिनेट करते हैं स्टेट लेवल के ऊपर, स्टेट एनकॉर्ड मीटिंग जिसके अंदर हम लोग सारे जो ड्रग लॉ एनफोर्समेंट एजेंसीज हैं उस पर्टिकुलर स्टेट की उनके साथ एनसीबी अपना संवाद स्थापित करती है और उनके हर पर्टिकुलर स्टेट में जो ड्रग्स से रिलेटेड समस्याएं हैं, जो वो चाहे वो ड्रग डिस्ट्रक्शन से रिलेटेड हो, चाहे वो सप्लाई ऑफ ड्रग्स से रिलेटेड हो, उनके ऊपर हम लोग समग्र रूप से काम करते हैं. दूसरा हम लोग काम करते हैं इंटरनेशनल कोऑर्डिनेशन के लिए. जितनी भी एनसीबी इज बेसिकली द प्रीमियर नोडल एजेंसी ऑफ गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया. वी हैव साइंड सो मेनी एग्रीमेंट्स विद डिफरेंट कंट्रीज इन दिस रिगार्ड. वी आर रिप्रेजेंटिंग इंडिया in various policy formulation issues across the world through UN or through INCB. We are also working in the field of creating awareness. That is one of the very important aspect of NCB. I must say we are creating awareness through social media, through our agencies which are basically spread across the countries. We are through Twitters, through YouTube, through different other social media campaigns that we are basically organizing time and again. And on the occasion of this last this year International Day Against This Drug Abuse, we have roped in a lot of celebrities from different industries like film industries, sports field, music field. These celebrities have given the important messages to the youth so that they should be weaned away from the drug abuse in India. At the same time, we are providing training to the officers of different drug law enforcement agencies, in not only the central drug law enforcement agencies but the state drug law enforcement agencies also. We are basically the nodal agencies. In this regard, we are imparting training not to the officers of the Indian government or the state government, but to the international officers also. We have provided training to the Sri Lankan officers, to Thai officers, to Myanmar officers at different point of time in this field. And last but not the least, I must say, we are assisting in providing funds to the different state under different schemes of the central government. That is assistance to state scheme. One of the scheme is NFCDS scheme. So through this scheme also, we are providing the fund, or rather we are basically playing the middle role between the Ministry of Home Affairs and the respective state's government for, so that the fund is sufficiently given to those state of authorities and they can work upon in the field of drug law enforcement. So this is, in nutshell, I would say, ye NCB ke jo mukhya roop se jo hum kar rahe hain, hum log kar rahe hain. एंड मुझे उम्मीद है कि हम लोग इन कार्यों में अपना अपना सफल और एक भारत को हम लोग जो आदरणीय माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी का नारा है ड्रग फ्री इंडिया, हम लोग उसमें सफल हों आने वाले समय में. थैंक यू. थैंक यू वेरी मच.
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सचिन जी, आपने काफी महत्वपूर्ण बातें बताई हमें एनसीबी के रोल के बारे में. Next on the panel, I would like to invite Mrs. Radhika Chakravarti, who is the Joint Secretary, Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, Government of India. Mrs. Radhika Chakravarti has assumed charge of as the Joint Secretary in the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment in September 2019. She looks after Social Defense Bureau in the ministry and is responsible for implementing various programs and schemes related to drug de-addiction, transgender persons, rehabilitation of beggars, Nasha Mukt Bharat Abhiyan, and other issues related to the social and economical empowerment target groups. Welcome, ma'am. My first question to you will be, what are the main programs of Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment in prevention, rehabilitation of children with drugs and substance abuse? Also, please tell us about Nasha Mukt Bharat Abhiyan.
Chairperson NCPCR, Member Secretary NCPCR, my co-panelists and viewers, a very good afternoon to all of you. And Richa, I would like to answer your second question first. You wanted me to talk about Nasha Mukt Bharat, which is very, very close to our heart in the ministry and need of the hour in the country at the moment. So on 15th August 2020, the Nasha Mukt Bharat Abhiyan was launched by Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment in 272 identified vulnerable districts. And this launch was done by the chief ministers, ministers and members of parliament, district magistrates in 32 states. So in the 10 months since its launch, various activities have been undertaken by these districts to innovatively reach out to the children and sensitize them about the substance use and ill effects associated with it. Several sports events with children, with youth, with a message of healthy lifestyle and staying away from drugs, cycle rallies, Nukkad Natak's, webinars, online sessions, and several competitions have been taken up to reach out children under this Abhiyan. So coming to statistics, till now around 6,600 schools have been reached out through various activities under the Abhiyan, and 13 plus lakh school students have been covered across the country so far. Women participation has also been effective in positively influencing the children at schools, at home and Anganwadis. And it has seen about 28 plus lakh women having participated in the Abhiyan activities. So this reach is complemented again by 8,000 plus active master volunteers who have been identified in each of these districts, who are mainly youth, working by fostering partnerships with the educational institutions and conducting programs along with these institutions. Besides this, there are 4,000 plus youth clubs and groups have been formed in schools with students, teachers and parents as members to conduct regular activities in schools on substance abuse. Social media has also been effectively utilized to spread the message on substance abuse through our handles of Twitter, Insta, YouTube, and the reach out is to around 17 plus lakh people on the social media. We also have about 250 plus social media interns who have been instrumental in extending the Abhiyan in the online space. So if you see, there has been a shift from organization-based approach towards a community-based approach to tackle the issue of substance abuse, which has led to a massive momentum for the Abhiyan throughout these 272 districts. Now, Abhiyan is actually a three-pronged approach. It's a strategy by combining substance abuse through demand reduction and outreach strategies by the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, and emphasis on treatment or harm reduction by Ministry of Health, and very importantly, curbing the supply of drugs and enforcement activities by the NCB. So now coming to the first part of the question is, the ministry emphasizes, you said what are the main programs of the ministry. So besides Nasha Mukt Bharat Abhiyan, the ministry emphasizes on a very integrated approach, and accordingly a national action plan for drug demand reduction has been prepared for 2018 and 25. This is a very comprehensive action plan which focuses on primary prevention, early intervention, treatment and rehabilitation, social integration, and on reducing the adverse consequences of substance abuse on individuals, which includes young adults and youth. According to the national survey, it is very alarming that there are about 100 crore poly substance users within the age group of 10 to 17 years. So therefore, there is a lot of focus on the awareness generation and sensitization of not just children in schools, but out of schools, as mentioned by the chairperson NCPCR, and also among the parents, teachers, women, educational institutions, civil society, and everyone who plays an important role in the child development. For this purpose, ministry has set up a program called a community peer-led intervention program, which is essentially driven by peers who are aged between 10 to 17 years, who are trained to engage with other children in meaningful activities and life skills after school hours under supervision. So there are 61 such CPLI programs in the country, and the reach out is to approximately 73,000 children in a year. So at present, there are 530 treatment, counseling and rehabilitation institutions funded by the ministry, which also have been geotagged for the easy access. And besides this, we are having this addiction treatment facilities, which are being set up in the government hospital with separate beds for the children. Richa, I think that answers your first question.
Yes, ma'am. That was wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing this very crucial information with us. Next on the panel, I would like to invite Dr. Sumita Ghosh, who is the Additional Commissioner in Charge, Child Health, RBSK, AH, CAC and AD, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. Sumita ji is a pediatrician by education and has 35 years of experience in clinics, training and administration in government. Ma'am, what are the main steps taken by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare in prevention and treatment of children with drugs and substance abuse?
Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity on this International Day celebration on drug and substance abuse and trafficking. Ministry of Health, it's very well aware, because this is one issue which is of serious public health importance, as well as maybe a growing public health issue. So there, apart from the legislative framework, the policy decisions, these are already there to put prevention as well as health management of these issues. The programs are being run on various platforms in the ministry. They are in the Child Health Division, RBSK program, then in the Adolescent Health Division. Some are being run by the Mental Health Divisions, some under the National Tobacco Control Program. There are programs being run at community level through our health and wellness centers, where screening and mental health is an issue where substance abuse comes in a big way. Then again, we have a NACO program, which is doing awareness generation for the drug users. We have programs, one very important recent programs, which are in the mostly now in the aspirational district. That is the Ayushman Bharat Health Ambassador Program. That is a school-based program along with the Department of Education. So there it is based on primary prevention, talking to the children through their most important influencer, that is the teachers. In that program, health ambassadors are planned to be made two in each school, who will be taking care of the children. There are 11 modules which have been made. One of them is on substance abuse, and there are also other issues, psychological issues and growing up issues, which are common in adolescents. So on various fronts, it is being addressed in the ministry. At the same time, the basic focus in health ministry is on the prevention part, primary prevention part, the awareness generation, screening, early detection, and then through various convergences to have them get treated through our mental health units also, and through the Ministry of Social Justice, the de-addiction centers and all. So through convergence, through various platforms, we are trying to address this. One most important aspect I would like to say, where we have said that the schools will be free of drugs and influences of drugs. So our TOFER program, which is the tobacco-free educational institutional program, where the signage has to be there. Then there will be ambassadors, health ambassadors, and other monitors will be talking about tobacco effects and preparing the young minds for to win them out of influence of this peer pressure as well as tobacco influences and other drugs and substance abuse influences. So it was given, these guidelines came out in 2019. So this way, various way, through awareness, through primary prevention, through screening, through various other modalities, and RBST program again is one very important platform through which this can be addressed, because we have around 11,500 teams which are all over the country. Can very well do it, but again, I'll come to that later, what can be issues in it. And our adolescent health program, again, it is very geared up to this issue. We have adolescent-friendly health clinics where adolescents do visit, and we have footfalls of 35 lakhs in 2021. Then we have adolescent health counselors. They're trained counselors. We have some 1,600 of them, trained ones. They also talk, and they also talk people out of them, this menace. As well as we have peer educators, the peer group activities, and adolescent sort of camps and various other activities in the peer groups, through which we try to address this, because we know this one very vulnerable age group, where they are also experimenting and also under peer pressure. So this is a very, very, very potential dangerous situation. When they fall into this trap, and maybe they if not supported, they cannot come out of it, and that influences their future potentials, careers, vocations, education, everything. So various ways we are Ministry of Health is addressing this issue.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Next on the panel, I would like to invite Dr. Anju Dhawan, Professor, National Drug Dependence Treatment Center, and also the in-charge Adolescent Drug Abuse Treatment Clinic at National Drug Dependence Treatment Center, AIDS. Welcome to this webinar, ma'am. I have two questions for you. The first one is, what are the common drugs and substances children generally use? Or what are the warning signs associated with these? And my second question to you will be, what are the key issues and challenges with respect to treatment and rehabilitation of children with drugs and substance abuse? Please tell our viewers about this.
Thank you, Richa. I would like to thank the chairperson NCPCR for giving me this opportunity to share some of the aspects related to this very vulnerable population, and my greetings to my co-panelists and the viewers. So if we look at substance use in the country, basically the most common substances are tobacco and alcohol, followed by inhalants, cannabis and opioids. These are the other three substances which are commonly seen. Now there is some recent data in terms of how common it is. So I would like to share that data to give you an idea about how common are we talking about substance, these five substances that I just mentioned. So recently a 10 city student survey has been completed with support from the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, which has produced data from across different parts of the country. There are 10 different cities involved. And what that data showed was that tobacco and alcohol was about 4% each, 4% and 3.8%. And the other drugs were about 2% when we talk of inhalants and cannabis. But opioids was quite large, 2.8%. This is any use in last 1 year. So these are the sort of substances which are commonly seen. And these figures are higher than the data that has come from the household survey for children. If you look at the children data in the household survey, this is higher because these are interviews which have taken place in school settings in an anonymous kind of survey where the child knows that nobody is watching him and he can fill up the questionnaires. And many of these children who had any time used a substance in their life, they have continued to use, you know, in the last 1 year, even in the last 1 month. But the good part is that by and large, the frequency of use has been occasional for most of the children. Only some were using it on a more or less regular basis. So this is as far as the magnitude of substance use in India, which has come from the student survey. And there is, of course, data from the household survey, which gave figures of about 0.9% for cannabis and 1.8% for opioids, and another about 1.7% for inhalants. So this gives us some idea about the magnitude. The second question which you asked was that what are the issues that are related to substance use in children? See, when we talk of children, I think prevention becomes even more important than intervention. Because if we catch them early, then we can prevent the substance use from escalating and them developing problems due to that. So from that perspective, it is very important to understand the vulnerability. You know, what are the factors that are leading to vulnerability? And there is some understanding that has developed from this recent data on those aspects as well. You know, in terms of, let's say, exposure to friends who are using substances, in terms of exposure to family members who are using substances, in terms of a disturbed family environment where there are conflicts in the family, or in terms of the own psychological vulnerability of the child. You know, for instance, the student survey showed that about 25% of the children have some kind of psychological vulnerability, whether it is in terms of inattentiveness, hyperactivity, emotional problems, relationship issues, etc. So this is the group of children, if you intervene early, because they have friends using substances, family members, or there are conflicts in the family, or they are psychologically vulnerable, then we can prevent the escalation of substance use. So one important issue to flag here is prevention. And when I talk of prevention, awareness and education is one aspect of prevention. Of course, beyond that, for instance, these children who are vulnerable, they may need counseling if you're talking about school settings. You know, so that they have not yet started substances, they may not go into substance use. That becomes important. Then teaching basic drug refusal skills, how to say no if you're offered. To teach parents educating them about what is good parenting, which can prevent substance use, you know, how to develop a good relationship with your child, a supportive relationship, disciplining your child as well as monitoring their activities, knowing their friends, knowing how they are spending their time, who they are spending their time with. These are some of the important aspects. So recently we have developed three films for Samagra Shiksha on parent education and parenting, how to do good parenting, and small animation film for children about how to say no. If someone offers you tobacco, alcohol or other substances, how to say no. So this is one aspect, which is the prevention aspect. The more challenging aspect is children who are already using substances. Very often the parents may not come to know about it, you know, because sometimes a few years elapse before a child uses substances and the parents come to know. Because the signs which are there are very soft signs, you know, these are signs which may otherwise be seen in any adolescent also. So for instance, the child may not be so much interested in academics. He may miss classes, his grades may go down, he may start missing school. So those are some of the academic kind of indicators. Or there may be behavioral issues, throwing some tantrums, not spending time with parents, not relating well to them, or emotional issues showing, you know, up and down mood swings, getting angry, irritable, maybe demanding money, spending money excessively, you know, getting into fights, or a peer group which is of other users. So these are some of the indicators that can, you know, getting into fights, that can help the, sometimes indicate that maybe the child is, you know, spending a lot of time outside home, that he may be using something. But none of these are definitive for that. These are just indicators. So very often there is a time which elapses between the child, you know, using substances and parents coming to know. So there is a window of opportunity there for the schools, because teachers are seeing the child every day. They can for extended periods in the classroom. So based on their observation, they may be able to identify some behavioral changes, some emotional changes. And there is an opportunity there for referring these children to the school counselors. So it's very important, at least for the children who are in schools, early identification, referral to school counselors, and intervention by the counselors. And if you see the list of substances that I talked about, whether it's tobacco, whether it's alcohol, whether it's cannabis or inhalants, at least these four substances, except opioids, do not have very prominent physical withdrawals. So the mainstay of intervention is psychological intervention, and it can be provided by counselors in the school setting. The role of doctors comes in if a person is using opioids regularly, has withdrawals, may need medication, etc. So for children, we have to focus on providing intervention where they are. If they are in the schools, we provide intervention there. If they've dropped out from the school, they're in the community, then the NGOs do the outreach, they provide intervention there. Only a small percentage may need referral to very specialized kind of healthcare facilities for medication, etc. So the challenge here is getting them involved in treatment, identifying, engaging them in the treatment process, retaining them in the treatment process, whether the treatment is taking place in the school or whether it's in the community or whether it's in a health facility. These are some of the challenges with children, because for we say drug use is a hidden phenomena. It's more so for children, you know, more so hidden for children. So and we know even in the student survey, it came out that, you know, about 5% of children had various problems, fights, injuries, relationship issues, getting interface with the police, those kind of problems children face when they get into, even if they may not be using on a regular basis, they may not be dependent, but many of them get into problems because, for instance, when you talk of alcohol, for young people, we say they often binge. When they drink heavily. They have risk of accidents. They have a risk of high-risk sexual behavior. So these are some of the issues I wanted to flag. It's a very important population to attend to. And I'm so happy that, you know, we are sitting here discussing this. And I hope we move forward and we can prevent some of the complications that occur in children who are using substances and the pain and trauma that the family goes through when they see their children going through this. I hope I've answered your questions, Richa. If there's anything else, I'm
good. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. That was wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Anju. You spoke of early intervention and prevention and how challenging it can be. So here, I would like to go back to Sri Sachin Jainji, who's the DDG of Narcotics Control Bureau. So could you tell us about the role Narcotics Control Bureau has to play in joint action plan for prevention of children from drugs and substance abuse and illicit trafficking?
Dr. Anju has elaborately discussed the part that we have to play with our kids as far as preventing them, early prevention and early detection. As far as NCB is concerned, NCB was associated with the joint action plan from the very beginning. So we were part and parcel of that main mechanism with NCPCR, definitely. NCPCR is being the mainstay of that. So to my understanding and what NCB perceives, a joint action plan has threefold rules or threefold ideas. First is that to create awareness as far as the entire legal positions that we have with respect to the drug issues pertaining to the drug uses or drug trafficking for the children. Second is that creating awareness among the children with respect to the drug abuse, so that they should know that they have to say no to drugs, as Dr. Anju has rightly said. It should be educated to them so that they should say no to that. And the third, we should also prevent the children to being part of that trafficking network, because many a time these traffickers are using the children's the youngsters as a trafficking partner, and they are basically getting into it. So I think we have to work on the threefold areas. NCB is working, of course, as I've initially said, that NCB is working in the prevention of the prevention side, so that there should not be there should be minimum of drug supply in India. That should be the motto, including the, so that is not with respect to the kids or the youngsters only, but in commonly with respect to the entire population. So the idea is to prevent the drug supply. It is not that NCB, even the state police officials, the customs officials, and many other drug law enforcement agencies which are working on this field. But NCB is playing a very important role as far as legislation is concerned in this field. We are doing a lot of trend analysis. We are studying international law also, and we are giving our important inputs as far as legislation is concerned, so that any law should have a complete concern of the population or of the Indians and Indian problems that we are basically encountering with. So we are participating in that. As I have said in the beginning, we are basically creating a lot of awareness among the youth. We have basically offices at around 25 different places in India. My all officers are working extensively, not during this week, but it is basically an year-long program. We are doing a lot of awareness program. Before COVID, we were basically working in the field through a marathon, through hackathon, and through different modes. We were basically trying to create awareness among the youth and among the general public so that they should say no to drugs. But during this COVID time, the restriction that we are basically going using the social media more and more, we are using Twitter, we are using Insta, we are using YouTube. As I have said in the beginning, we are roping in various celebrities also in this field. So we are pursuing very vigorously as far as this awareness campaign is concerned. And the coordination. I believe that coordination is the keyword right now. We have to, because it is not one agency's job. It has to be a comprehensively done by all agencies together. So different stakeholders which are involved in that, we are trying to coordinate their actions so that all agencies should talk on the same line, on the same page. They should speak the same language as far as policy of Indian policy against the drug abuse. So we are coordinating with the Central Drug Enforcement Agencies. We are coordinating with state drug law enforcement agencies, so that any child which is basically getting into the grip of this drug abuse, he should not be taken as accused. He should be considered as a victim, and we should basically treat those symptoms first rather than making him accused. So these are the few areas, as joint action plan has 7 or 8 different mottos. So we are trying to participate in all the motives for which joint action plan is working with. Thank you.
All right, sir. Thank you so much. I have another question for Ms. Radhika Chakravarti. Ma'am, you had earlier told us about the 272 vulnerable districts that were identified by the Ministry of Social Justice. So what is the main role that the Ministry of Social Justice has to play in the joint action plan? And how were these 272 vulnerable districts identified by the ministry? And what is the proposed action in the joint action plan for these districts?
Yes, Richa. So the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment is basically the nodal ministry for demand reduction, for which it coordinates, implements, and monitors several interventions, like which include prevention, sensitization, assessment of the extent of the problem, early intervention, counseling in various settings, and treatment and rehabilitation of users. So the joint action plan has essentially all the elements covered under the Nasha Mukt Bharat Abhiyan, and with an important role to be envisaged by MOSG. So the ministry's interventions will be instrumental in creating awareness, basically, and reducing the demand for substance, preparing outreach strategies for various stakeholders, and creating an environment which is conducive for people seeking help. Like, for example, children are being sensitized about the ill effects of the substance use, along with the emphasis on the important role played by the peers in discouraging the use of substance. Likewise, teachers' sensitization is being done to equip them with the knowledge of early identification of users, assessing the skills of the students, and map them to the life skills or the sports to divert them from falling into the vicious circle of the substance abuse. Likewise, parents are very important stakeholders who have to be sensitized and counseled to accept the problem of substance abuse in their children, along with creating a conducive situation where they are not scared or discouraged to seek treatment or help for their child. So parents also need to be being made aware on watching for the early signs of substance use, so that before it's too late. Now, coming to this 272 districts, these have been identified. These are supposed to be the most vulnerable, and these are identified based on the comprehensive survey, the findings of the comprehensive national survey, which the ministry has undertaken, and the findings of the survey on one side. And we have also discussed this with the NCB before the start of the Abhiyan, and we have obtained the supply side inputs, the enforcement side inputs from the NCB, and putting these two together, we have identified these 272 districts. Richa.
All right. Thank you so much, ma'am, for this information. Next on the panel, I would like to ask Dr. Sumita Ghosh yet another question. Ma'am, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare in 2019 released the guidelines for tobacco-free educational institutions. So could you tell our viewers more about this?
Thank you, Richa. During my first, I thought I'll start with saying that this document, the Joint Action Plan, it's a very well-executed document. You know, it's so comprehensively deals with the subject. Having said so, this 2019 guidelines, it is basically an attempt to make the schools, tobacco free. So, already designated and making signage on them that these are tobacco free schools. That is one of the components. Second one, as I said, that there will be monitors, health ambassadors will propagate this message of freedom from tobacco, try to make them tobacco free, and do everything, all kind of awareness, preventive activities to make it tobacco free. Another very important part is, you know, the area surrounding the schools, which should be made tobacco free. That is 100 years, which should be there should not be any anyone selling or anyone doing any kind of activity, any kind of advertisement. So basically it is making a bubble around the children to protect them from any kind of influence, because that is the main issue for adolescent school young minds, that they get into some kind of pressure. Someone drinking, someone smoking, they get into that kind of habit. So just making the environment free. So that is the idea of it. And one fourth component of this is that there should not be any, staff members, anyone should not be making it, having any kind of tobacco use, and all should be free of this. And the school health, that Ayushman Bharat School Ambassador Program, again, this kind of ideas have been developed. The schools, which is the major part of the students are spent there, and major influencers are there. The peers are the most important influencers, and also the teachers. So making both these influences, tobacco and other drugs also. So that was the idea behind this guideline. So
thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, definitely.
I want to answer the RBSK portion also, because any time, you must be noticing I am distracted. Yes. So please, what is your third question, please tell me.
Okay. Yes, definitely. So could you elaborate on the role the RBSK and RKSK has in the Joint Action Plan for screening and prevention of children from drugs and substance abuse? Go ahead. Thank you.
These two are very important programs of the ministry, which is directed towards children as well as adolescents. The RBSK is basically for the children, school age till 18 years, and RKSK is more concentrated on the adolescent health group. So RBSK program, basically what it does, there are 30 conditions, health conditions, plus tuberculosis and leprosy. So we have teams consisting of Ayush doctor and staff nurse, and also pharmacists. They go from in the community, and they visit the Anganwadis twice a year for the small children, and they visit the schools once a year. So these their basic idea is to create awareness as well as screen all children for these specified conditions, and also the when someone is needs referral, they refer to the district public hospitals or to our DIC centers are there. And these four D's are disease, deficiencies, delay, and birth defects. So these are the basic concentrated effort to find this. Now, in the Joint Action Plan, I can see that they will be trained, and they will be made their these visits more fruitful by screening out the any kind of addictions and all. That's a very great idea, because their reach is in every district, in every block they are there. So that idea is very good. The only issue I see here, the training, yes, they should be, because they are all in touch with students, and they can easily identify. Only thing, they go to school once in a year, and they screen some 132 students in a day. So the issue can be that the privacy, the confidentiality, the time which are needed for interactions, because seeing one child once in a year for a short while, So that we would try to see how we overcome that, because they need training also, but they need time also to be, you know, with the child, to know it. So our other school health programs, like ambassador programs and all, but school health ambassador program is only in aspirational districts now. We have some 36 districts we have covered till now, and because it is all COVID time, schools are all closed and all, so we could not do more what we wanted. So I understand that this plan is very well you know, thought of, but here we have, there's a scope for improvement when we involve the teachers, as Madam Anju was telling, that teachers, you know, they stay, and for any kind of detection or any kind of interaction, and even for management, it needs long, prolonged contacts. So teachers ideally are, so they can shortlist if they have something, they can, so both the mechanisms can be, you know, we can converge that. That is my suggestions here, and we'll try to work out like that. How RBSK and other our adolescent health programs, they can converge. RKSK is basically adolescent health programs, and there we have programs I already told. We have adolescent friendly health clinics, and we have counselors, trained counselors there, and we do have the peer educators. So all these mechanisms are, they that is very much suitable, you know, they are in the community and they do it. Otherwise, our health and wellness centers, which like 1.5 lakhs of them will come out at the sub-center and PSC level, and they are being upgraded in the sense that number of service provisions will increase, and one of them will be directed towards mental health, yoga and all. So that again can be one touching point. The issue with adolescent is that they are those who are in school, their timings don't match with our system. They are reach, you know, we can't reach them easily. The easiest way is through schools to reach them. So strengthening school health program and keeping this focus on substance abuse, yes. Otherwise our oral health program is also there. So many programs, and what I feel that we in silos, we are doing many things, like Ms. Radhika said, everyone, NCB, everyone, and there is a very good legal framework both for for punitive actions, for imposing actions, as well as for rehabilitative action, like Juvenile Justice Act. So both the ways, laws are there, policies are there. Where we think we need to strengthen is the implementation part. Like we screen and we find, and the screening not only through RBSK, in our health, this can be screened anywhere in the community and all. Then when they go, they need a place to go. So that visibility, I request Ms. Radhika to, you know, all these centers which are there, the addiction centers, that visibility should be there in all our hospitals, in all our, you know, media. So because this is one issue, people don't want to talk much. They should have the knowledge, and though they have intention, they must be able to go. So I think that kind of awareness, where treatments can be done and where actually this long-term contacts and you know, which is needed for de-addiction or bringing them out of any kind of drug abuse. So that visibility should be much, much more. Like we all know about Alcoholic Anonymous, because that visibility is there, but again, the public system visibility must be there. So that kind of convergence, and all our workers, health workers must know where to send, how to send, all these things should be made much more streamlined. That is my idea, that it should, how it should be streamlined.
All right.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So before we take any live questions, if they are there, I would like to ask Dr. Anju Dhawan once again about substance use prevention and intervention in school settings. So if you could elaborate a little about how what would be your recommendations and how to go about it.
Richa, I think most of the issues I've already discussed in school settings, what all we can do in terms of prevention, early identification, treatment aspects. One thing I would like to say that the issues that were raised by Dr. Ghosh, they're right that in terms of you know, sensitivity of the issue, privacy, confidentiality, those have to be maintained, disclosure to parents, those are very sensitive issues which have to be dealt delicately. And the counseling, of course, cannot be done by teachers. Their role can be only identification has to be done by counselors in the schools. So overall, I see a huge need for capacity building, whether we are talking about schools, counselors, or whether we are talking about NGOs and their ability to handle substance use issues in children in terms of treatment. Because all these years, our focus in the field of substance use has been a lot on the adult population. And now, of course, we are giving a lot of focus to the child population as well. And already a lot of work is being done, like Radhika ji told. So, but capacity building is an area that needs a thrust here. And so that is something that one needs to work on. Whether it is manuals in terms of, you know, training the school counselors, whether we talk of that, or when we talk of adolescent friendly health clinics, for example, there are nursing staff there. In some of the states, counselors also, I think, are there. They could be the first level of screening for children who are seeking help for general health services. But we did a study in 25 adolescent friendly health clinics in Delhi, and we found very low substance use in that population. So probably children who are using substances are not coming forward so much to the clinics for seeking help. So then the role of NGOs becomes important, connecting them to health services. So I think it involves multi-pronged approach, multiple stakeholders, capacity building, whether it's community, school, and also healthcare facilities, including largely outpatient kind of healthcare facilities, but some inpatient healthcare facilities should also be there for adolescents, which now are being developed under the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, I'm told. So these are some of the issues that really need to be addressed where this population is concerned. I went a little beyond school settings because I thought I had covered some of those things, and it is important to focus on these areas.
Definitely, ma'am. Thank you so much. So since we have no live questions right now, so I would like to invite Srimati Rupali Banerjee Singh, who is the Member Secretary NCPCR, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Drug and substance abuse among children and adolescents is becoming a global health issue. Shared facts on drugs save lives is the theme of the 2021 International Day Against Drug Abuse and Illicit Trafficking, marked on 26 June. This year's theme aims at combating misinformation and promotes sharing the facts on drugs, from health risks and solutions to tackle the drug problem to evidence-based prevention, treatment and care. In order to mark this week, National Commission for Protection of Child Rights with Narcotics Control Bureau has organized this webinar to disseminate information on the Joint Action Plan on Prevention of Drugs and Substance Abuse among Children and Illicit Trafficking, developed jointly with NCB and all the concerned respective ministries and other stakeholders. I would like to sincerely thank Honorable Chairperson NCPCR Shri Priyam Kanungo Ji for sharing his views on this important and sensitive issue of drugs and substance abuse among children and his vision on prevention through joint action. I would like to express my gratitude to Shri Sachin Jain, Deputy Director General, Narcotics Control Bureau, for sharing the role of NCB and giving valuable information on this issue and taking out time for this webinar. I would like to thank Ms. Radhika Chakravarti, Joint Secretary, Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, for enlightening all of us with important work of the ministry on this issue of drugs and substance abuse. Our sincere thanks to Dr. Sumita Ghosh, from Ministry of Health and Family Welfare for sharing your valuable experience and work being done by the ministry in this regard. I would like to give my thanks to Dr. Anju Dhawan from NDDTC AIIMS for sharing clinical aspects of the issue of drugs and substance abuse among children and other relevant information for parents and teachers. My thanks to Ms. Richa Dwivedi from New India Junction for moderating this webinar, and NIJ Media and IT team for providing media support. Thanks are also due to Ms. Shayasta K. Shah, STE, NCPCR Health Division, media team of NCPCR and IT team for all the hard work. Thank you all the viewers for watching this webinar with NCPCR. Thank you.